Hello and welcome to the Homeless World Cup podcast. I'm Adam Wilson.
I'm Mariana Mercado.
I'm Paul Hyland.
Join us as we discuss homelessness, the unifying power of sport, and look at what goes into making the Homeless World Cup tournament possible.
It's then that I decided, what is it that I didn't do in soccer? It has to do with soccer. I played, I commentated, I became a leader. I said, no, let me become a referee.
At the age of 16, Fezile Hlophe became the youngest professional soccer referee in South Africa. Like millions of young people all over the world, he was football obsessed, but at the age of 12, he was sadly diagnosed with throat cancer. He refused to let that get in the way of his ambitions, however. Once he beat cancer, he decided to look at other ways he could get involved in football, ways that weren't as physically demanding, and refereeing was just the thing. Fezile's story is told in the Amazon Prime series This Is Football, and he kindly visited us in Cardiff back in July to screen his episode for the players. He also took some time out to speak to us for the podcast, talking about his childhood using bottle caps to plan tactics for matches, his first professional game, and why football unites people. This was one of the first episodes we recorded for the podcast in a sweltering little tent on the tournament site, so there is a little bit of background noise, but we hope you enjoy.
I grew up in a very small township where, you know, many kids, they really liked playing football. And we really had best players around the area, but they couldn't get opportunities, you know, to go as far as they can with their career in football. But nevertheless, I grew up very, very in love with football, and it's something which kept me going for quite like every day. And, you know, you wake up, you think about football. During the day, you think about football. In the afternoon, in the evening. So, yeah, it was like that. We used to play bottle caps. And
bottle caps.
We used to have a very small-sided pitch in my house where we play. I think that was the only way to play football as a game. You know, because we didn't have opportunities to, or any chances to have PlayStations, you know, to play those matches. So the only way we could enjoy ourselves was to, you know, play the bottle caps down the in the yard. And it was really, really something very, very interesting to play. And almost all the kids in my era, they felt in love because I started doing all those things. And I used to play alone. But as time goes on, I saw that it will bring more interest if I bring a little bit different people to come and play. And I mean, even if you can ask the whole street, most of our kids, even now, those ones who are grown up, I mean, a lot of people played it. You know, they really, really showed character.
So, what's it been like at the tournament so far?
I mean, it's been an amazing weekend so far. I mean, so excited to be here, you know, having to meet different people as this tournament. I mean, it's what I've seen is I've seen some love within players and fans, and it's pretty an amazing thing to do. And it's been an awesome weekend. I'm so excited to be here, and yeah, for the fact that it's a game of football, I mean, it really, really unites. I mean, it really, really unites people.
And how many matches have you managed to watch so far?
Yeah, I mean, I've watched a lot of different matches, and they're so exciting to watch them. I mean, they really, really, you know, catchy, and I like the quality the standard. What I mean is the standard of how mentally all players are prepared, and the fact that fans have a very good supportive system in trying to encourage them to play a little bit more. But what I feel like is the time that is allocated is a bit short. But yes, there's nothing you can do about that. But yeah, I'm pretty excited. I mean, it's been amazing so far.
And is it a stupid question, me asking, but what's your favorite team?
Yeah, well, my favorite team, it's South Africa, obviously. And yeah, you know, and the reason is that I'm from South Africa, so we need to support them throughout. But I mean, it's they all favorite, if I can just put it in a nutshell. So they're playing a very wonderful football, all of them. I like the fact that we have high scores. It doesn't mean when they're losing, they don't play very beautiful football, but it's I mean, they've played a very wonderful football so far, all of them. So, yeah, but the favorite team is South Africa, and I wish they can, you know, win this tournament. But this, I like the fact that they are very, very hungry for this. They always, I mean, have that spirit of winning, and yeah, I think it can really, really work if they continue with the same mentality, you know, approaching all these matches.
And as well as being so focused, South Africa, they bring a certain energy to the tournament. They are, they seem to be the backbone of the joy and just the spirit of what the tournament is about.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's our culture in South Africa. When we go out and play in other different countries, you know, we really fight in trying to, you know, to win matches. Not really competition, but to win matches in records. So it's a very good thing they're doing. I'm very impressed. I didn't know we have homeless players in South Africa until I came here, and it really now gives me a push to be part of their journey, even if they come back to South Africa, you know, understand a little bit more. Maybe if I could help somewhere with my experience in football. So yes, I really like the spirit. I like the fact that they're giving it all out. They're so relaxed, you know. Mm. They're so comfortable with the environment. They play what we prefer in South Africa. Yes, and I mean with the fact that they also having a lot of number of goals, which is a good thing. Mm-hmm. And it can really, really improve their playing standard, and this is an amazing experience in watching them. So excited to really, really, I mean, come here and have also my country, you know, participating in this big event.
Mm-hmm. And of course you are from South Africa, you're from Soweto. Growing up, you said you wanted to be a football player. Is that right?
Yes, I was a soccer player. I was a captain in my team. The name of the team was called Foxes. So I was a captain I was a captain for under 10s. I became a captain for under 11, 13, 15, and I was very good. I think the thing that made me become a captain on that time is skills that I had in running. I was so passionate. So each and every kid in my neighborhood, they would like look up to me, you know, with that. So they are the ones who made me to become a captain. I was a very good striker. In a season, I have managed, especially under 13. There was a time where we were three strikers in the team, and I think I was the top goal scorer, but when the season ended, so the other players, you know, went up on me, and I was having like 22 goals with one season.
Wow!
In under 11s, so we were having records.
Uh-huh.
Down there. So, and when these other players came in, they wanted to also, you know, show character, you know, they wanted to show that they really want to score. But sometimes, you know, they were like, my friends, they were like, say, no, you that was an offside, the referee didn't see that, you scored with, how many goals did you score, it was an offside. I was like, no, but at the end, it's a goal, it was counted.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and then the 13s, I ended the season around like 19, if I can remember well, it was 19 goals. That was back in 2013.
Wow.
And the other players were running, they were very far from me during that time. They were like 28 goals. I remember there was a friend of mine, he's from Mozambique. He used to play for our team in South Africa. Mm-hmm. So he had about like 26 goals with that season. He was a top goal scorer. And the other one, the second from him was from South Africa. He scored about like 24 of those, and I was in 19 that time. So it really kept a very, very good shape on that time. So I was a very good striker. They really trusted on me with everything. And then until I stopped, because that was a time when I stopped playing football. It was in 2013. So due to the fact that I had to had some challenges somehow with regards to the health and all these health conditions. And from then, it took a lot of time to go back to the field. It took a lot of time.
The transition from wanting to become a professional football player to becoming a ref, what made that change?
Yeah, the thing is, in 2013, I stopped playing soccer.
Mm-hmm.
I had to go to hospital. I was so sick for that condition. I couldn't go back to soccer after 2 years because I was in hospital for like quite 2 years trying to...
What was the issue?
Yeah, so I think the other thing is, I used to play a lot of, I invested a lot of time in at our grounds. So our grounds are in soil, so it's not grass.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's where I got that sickness. So I ended up having throat cancer.
Oh dear.
Yeah, so I didn't know what happened. I wasn't sure what was happening. But
and you felt like you couldn't go back to the pitch after that?
Yeah, the time in hospital, to spend 2 years.
2 years.
2 years, it wasn't easy. And remember, this chemotherapy treatment is not an easy one.
No.
To take it, so, and it kills all the body cells, right? But I kept on watching soccer. When you have fell in love from the first time, you don't stop, So, it was really challenging during that two-year process. And then I had to think again, am I fit to go back? And looking at how far are those players which have played, so they're very far now. It will be really, really not easy to catch.
To catch up with them.
Yeah, it's not really. And another thing is sometimes you get sick, you go back to the field, you're still going to sit quiet because they won't really give you, the opportunity to recover quickly. Mm. But what I came with is, I'm very passionate in soccer. I've used to commentate for in bottle caps. I've used to commentate in our tournaments. So it's then that I decided, what is it that I didn't do in soccer? What has to do with soccer? I played, I commentated, I became a leader. I said, let me become a referee.
So you used that passion to become something else, but still in soccer.
See, still in soccer. I've looked at all things I've done so far. So that's when I decided, let me become a referee. So after 2 years, within 8 months, there was a very strong training I was having. So I had a lot of running after being released in the hospital. They said, you don't have a cancer now. We managed it, we cleaned it. You are so fortunate to be cured. So within that 8 months, I had a lot of running until I went to some association of referees. Mm-hmm. I got land, I rode levels, level 1, 2, and 3, passed them, moved to professional. I was promoted because I did a final, national final games. It's like a big tournament like this, doing a final. Mm-hmm. Then they said, let's promote him to big matches. That's where now it all started,
I see.
Went to those professional games. Everything just ended up being, opened. That spirit of being in love with soccer came back. And the unfortunate thing is that when I went back when I get into the professional, then my team, which I used to play, they decided to, terminate everything. They've closed it. Now there's no longer a team.
I see.
A lot of players, young players, were indisciplined. Things didn't very well. Especially when I went into hospital, things didn't quite go well.
Mm-hmm.
So it was really, really something. It was a disaster during that time. So the team was closed, and it was really hard for me, you know, to go, because what I wanted to do is, now I'm in professional, let me try and create opportunities for these players. But so unfortunately, the team was closed. And then on that time, I decided, no, let me start my own team. Let me not use the very same name and the very same team, because people were no longer having interest in the team.
Right, okay.
I went back to my community and I started my own team. That was after joining the national panel, refereeing in professional. And, you know, started with a very small group of kids. It grown until it were today. I mean, today it's a very big team.
How old were these kids when you started?
They were 9, 10, 11 years of age.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, so I started with them. I was using whatever that I can to ensure that they play in a very safe environment. So whatever money I was getting there, it's going straight to them, you know.
I see. Just
giving them, buying soccer kits and all of those, sports and everything. And then it grew. You know, a lot of kids, now they started to see, oh, there's another team back in our community, and it grew until where it is today. So today we have under 11s, 13, 15s, and under 17s.
Wow.
So there are about like 90 of them.
Wow, 90?
Yeah, 90 players, yes, within a team. So I'm the manager. I've tried to also recruit coaches. So I'm still working on them getting qualifications to how to coach, because you need to know how to coach an under nine, you know. There are principles on how to, and elements, how to, you know, do a training session for under nine. What is the important factor in that, or key factors in that? So it's a very good thing that I think I've done for my community. This was the only way to get back, I mean, to give back to the community. Yeah. And yeah, I mean, so far so good. So in that, and then all started to open after that. Many things opened. We worked with different companies, especially big companies. They were so interested with the story. How did it happen? And yeah, I mean, the first company we had, it was APSA. So APSA was in, I think it was working with Barclays, this partnership format there. So APSA is a very biggest company, it's a bank, it's like a corporate company. So they came in, they wanted to do a story of Prosper. So what we mean by Prosper is, from here, this is how you have grown, this is how you have achieved. And they did a very big story. It was seen by a lot of South Africans. They were much more interested. And then again, many opportunities started to be created after from that day, because we had companies from Sweden came down, all from Sweden, to come and also get information about how did it happen. And
so the interest just grew from
there. Yeah, from the opportunities started to to open up. So I mean, all media papers in South Africa, I was in there, you know, and all broadcasting televisions in South Africa, I was in there being interviewed, especially. But the story behind is, how did it happen within 8 months, you know?
8 months, that's a
after
short...
from treatment to death. And then that really surprised, because it's not easy. So if you can get a sense of the story, it's all about hope, right? It's about hope. It's about it can be possible. It's how you think and how you get prepared to, you know, go back to whatever you have felt in love with, especially getting sick and trying to, because it's very important to keep fit. I was so active in my childhood in hospital. I was very, very active. I would ask questions, I would play games. The very fortunate part is that our hospital was very, very, was having a lot of sponsors. So it was like home, because they're doing it for those kids. It's not easy. Like I said, it's not easy. It's really, really not easy. The treatment, it can mentally turn you down. It
takes a lot out of you.
So, I mean, this whole side of the story, it's an amazing story to share. So we did share it with the different countries. And yeah, until we met This Is Football, and we also got an opportunity to also share the story. But now the question is how we moving forward, and but it's getting there along. I mean, the other step to move forward was to also come into Homeless World Cup.
Yeah.
Because it's we didn't thought of, you know, coming to Homeless. We didn't know about Homeless World Cup. We didn't have any idea that one day we'll be having story to share as well in a World Cup. So this is a part of moving forward, if I may just add on to all the conversation, and hoping that we'll keep on, you know, moving from one place to another, trying to, you know, to explain it and trying to give hope to people that even if you're sick, even if you have this challenge, you can, you know, even if you don't know what to do, if after being a player, this is a way to, you know, to do it.
So going back to your reffing, your first professional refereeing was in the multi-choice Disky Challenge. Was
yes.
It the Kaiser Chiefs and University of Pretoria?
University of Pretoria, yes.
And how did that go for you?
No, it went normal. You remember, I was a referee before I went yeah. into the professional. So I used to officiate big matches, very big, strong matches. With regards to local teams.
So you just treat it as normal? You
know? Yeah, it was a very normal game. It's just that the standard is not the same. But with the attitude I had, I mean, it was a very normal game.
A lot of the interest on you comes from your age. I mean, you're the youngest professional referee in South Africa. Do you feel like your age affects how players treat you, especially on the professional level?
Not really. You know, in professional, we all professional. It doesn't matter. And the fact is that those guys, they have been told how important it is to win a match, and how important it is to respect officials.
So no disrespect. So,
no, there's no disrespect with mm-hmm. with regards to that. They really show profession. Because the other thing is, we as referees in South Africa, we have a very, very strong constitution against players. So players, they really have to respect officials, regardless of the age, whatever, gender, it doesn't matter. They really have any appointed official they need to. So they really show respect. With regards to that, it's only a few players will give you a challenge, but it's part of game. I mean, mm-hmm. it's part of a men's game.
And you've got no fear?
No, there's no. You can't be having a fear.
No.
You can't be. That's where you become very strong. So, local games they gave me a strong strength to run big games. It really really gave me a strong strength to really run those games. So. What I could say is, now professional football, you can't disrespect the referee.
Right.
Otherwise, you'll be punished not to play. So,
no matter the age, you have to respect.
No matter how short I am or tall I am,
yeah,
you have
absolutely.
To respect the referee.
Obviously, you are one of the key figures in Amazon original series, This Is Football. How did Amazon approach you?
Now, with regards to Amazon, they were with the company called Brutal October, so the one that came to make a story, and they were the ones to, you know, run the whole program.
And this was taken to Amazon?
Yes, yeah. It was taken to the Amazon, and they were also inspired by the fact that, you know, it's a very good story.
Mm-hmm.
And remember, Amazon is a big company as well internationally. So they also would really like to share something which people, they will have a talk on it, which people they will have to inquire more about it, you know. So
there's going to be much more interest after.
Yes.
Are you looking forward to the premiere?
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I mean, it's been a great work. We've been working very hard to put the story out, and I mean, it's amazing to really see how hard we worked during that time in making sure that we really, you know, share an inspiring story to people so that people can be motivated, so that people can be able to have hope in whatever they're doing, especially those who are sick, especially those who are looking to get opportunities in playing football. And for those who don't really know what to do, who are still homeless, who don't really know what opportunities are there for them, you know.
And how important do you think football is in social change?
I think it's very important because it transforms change in a very different way. Number one, it brings positivity in your mind. It changes your behavior. You get to meet people. You get to go travel places. You experience different things. You become an analyst. You become a referee. You become a sports journalist with all of that. You become a coach as well, a mentor, a guide. So there are a lot of different opportunities.
It's really multifaceted, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah. You can go through media and be able to catch those fancy passes. So you can video analysis. So there's a lot of, you know, a lot of things.
I mean, and it's simple as well. You can play on the street. You can play.
You can play anywhere.
You can play anywhere.
You can play anywhere with regard to football. And even a small, you can even kick something which has to, maybe like an orange.
Yeah.
Play with an orange.
Anything round.
Yes. And you treat it as a football. So it's something very, very, I mean, it's an amazing thing to do.
What is This Is Football about, if you could give us a rundown?
So This Is Football, it's about telling stories, right? About football, how it transforms in helping people reach their success in football. And the 6-part series we have now, it's very interesting to watch because it talks about different, people within it, sharing their story on how they really felt in love with football and how it has really changed their lives to better. So as far as I know, This Is Football is all about sharing stories, all about love, it's all about the emotion and the spirit of soccer and yeah, that is as far as I know. But yeah,
and it's different looks, it's different stories throughout, and different aspects on how football has affected people's lives. Is that correct?
Yes, yeah. Exactly. Yeah, that's correct. Because it has, you know, the fact that it goes around different countries, getting those stories. It doesn't really choose which country. No, it went to China, it went to India, yeah. It went to South Africa, it went to England, it went to, you know, the mixture of these countries, having to see how powerful is football impacting in people's life. I mean, it really, really does an awesome job.
Thank you very much, Fezile.
Thank you so much.
For the new, obviously you've got This Is Football coming out. Apart from that, what's in the future for you?
Like I said, with regards to moving forward, and what is important is the future on what you always do, because you need to try and have certain goals on when you do something, you know. Where do you really want to reach? You may set goals, but you reach those goals, but you haven't reached them enough. Or you even, go to that as far as you can. So what I mean is, with regards to, my refereeing, I really want to, you know, continue, you know, uplifting. It mustn't be only refereeing, uplifting people, helping motivate them throughout refereeing. And obviously to ref in big matches, FIFA World Cup matches, European matches, what those big matches, you know, those big matches, we it's always the wish to be there. Because somehow you get to get more experience and get to understand different crowds, how people can sweat you. You get to understand all of those, you know. So it's a very, very good it can be a very, very good opportunity to be part of those in the future.
And I'm sure you will keep moving forward. Thank you very much, Fezile.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for joining us this week on the Holmes World Cup podcast. Please tune in next time when we discuss the issue of rough sleeping with Lindsay Cordery-Bruce, who is the head of Wales' leading homeless charity, The Wallach, and Mike Wright, Senior Service Manager of Outreach Services with Scottish charity Serenians. Email us at podcast@homelessworldcup.org with things you'd like to hear discussed, or get in touch with us on social media. If you enjoyed it, please give us a rating of 5 stars on iTunes or give us a share online.
Help us keep the ball rolling by going to homelessworldcup.org/donations or search for Homeless World Cup Foundation in Just Giving.
Theme music, Daffodil Hill by Buzzard, Buzzard, Buzzard.
This podcast is brought to you by the Homeless World Cup Foundation, presented by Paul Hyland, Adam Wilson and Mariana Mercado, produced by Adam Wilson and Paul Hyland.